All right, are we good to go? Nice. Okay, it's good to be here. Very nervous and very excited about this thing. Healthcare operations and innovations is exciting for two reasons. The first reason is that assume that all of you, like myself, want to make the world a better place. It's part of our mission as human beings. We want to make the world a better place. Okay, but we have to choose a sector where we want to operate. And healthcare is a troubled industry everywhere. The troubles are different in developing countries like India and advanced countries like the United States or Europe, but nevertheless, there is no country in the world where the general public, or the government, or the politicians would be satisfied with the health services that they have at the moment. So there is a lot of room for improvement. We have been working in my place with my students with several hospitals and health clinics. And if you observe what's happening in those places, you will see that they are very, very badly managed. You can, like a couple of my students, some 15 years ago, they did a seminar work in an orthopedic hospital. They analyzed the processes following standard industrial management methods, and they devised a way to cut 10 to 15% of the cost. Now, if you go to some other industry, where can you do this kind of cost cutting or improvement in those sort of big chunks? I have one of my students who was working at a brewery in a bottling plant. He spent half a year, you know, doing all these sophisticated simulations, things about the bottle logistics, and the team they could shave off something like 0.00001% of the total cost. So that's the reason why, you know, in my place we have a lot of students who are very much interested in healthcare, because that's a place where you can make an impact to make the world a better place. And if you do good, then you can do well also, meaning that you can get rich, or at least well off, if you come up with some kind of ideas that make healthcare better and more efficiently meet the needs of people. So there's a lot of scope for innovations, entrepreneurship, the adaptation of new technologies, new management methods and things. So the field is open. It's like the Wild West. Go west, young man, and do something great. The second reason why this is very exciting is from an academic point of view. And the second excitement is, I'm going to talk about it during these days, it's the question of how to understand services. So service production systems have been around for a long time. In advanced countries, services are up to 60-70% of GNP. So services are big and they are growing compared to agriculture and manufacturing. But the management of services is still undeveloped. So we don't have the same kind of precision technologies that you can find in manufacturing and other industrial areas where you can sort of exactly and precisely manage quality, supply chains, or cutting. Services are difficult. A lot of services, service systems have developed just, you know, through trial and error, not necessarily through scientific thinking or technological planning. Why? Simply because we don't know how to do it. It's not for lack of trying, because service research, service science has been a growing field for long time. It's simply that the world of human behavior is different from nature. In nature, we can sort of find rules and regularities and laws of nature, like physics, chemistry, even life science. But in society, there are not sort of similar kind of regularities, because the economy changed, the situation changed, and then all of a sudden, you know, the rules and behaviors of people change. So it would be like, say, if we go to a physics, and then the world will be such that, say, some fundamentals of physics would change all the time. Sometimes we would have gravity, then the next moment you would have no gravity at all, and next moment the gravity would go the other way, and then back again. And this, all this would be unpredictable. Then how would we build physics? We build it like behavioral sciences today. We try to sort of struggle with a world that's not easily sort of captured in theories and principles and models. So that's exciting to try to develop sort of new ideas, new concepts and models, how to better get a grasp of how service systems could be designed and developed to do the good things that we want them to do. So there are these two motivations. Give you a little background about myself, how I get into this area. I'm not an engineer. My background is in social sciences, a PhD in sociology from Helsinki University. I get into industrial management through a coincidence. When I was young, I was very much interested in Asian cultures and wanted to go to Japan. So I got a scholarship from the Japanese Ministry of Education and went there in 1982 to study Japanese management. In those days, Japanese management was the hottest thing on earth, because the Japanese manufacturing industry has developed a number of methods like quality management, total quality management, and all these things that nowadays are called lean production. It has stabilized into this whole concept of lean. But it was new and upcoming in the 1980s, and the life in Japan was very exciting in the sense that it was a growing economy, and many decent people in the West thought that the Japanese are going to take over the world. Today it sounds like a joke. Today, all the decent people think that China is going to take over the world. 5 years down the road, we think it's a joke. Then we start thinking that India is going to take over the world. What happens then, I don't know. But you know, you have all these kind of popular ideas of where the world is going and what's happening. Anyway, in 1980s, Japan was on top of the world, and I was there. And did my doctoral thesis about quality management in Japanese industry. Most of course in the car industry, but cars and heavy trucks and stuff like that. Then after graduating, I worked with the Boston Consulting Group. It's a big American consulting outfit in Tokyo and Stockholm. And then I was for a while at the Stockholm School of Economics, and then since 1994 in my current position. So my sort of first research venue was quality. I still think quality is an interesting concept. We'll discuss it in a moment. It's interesting in the sense that it's a bridge between engineering and marketing. And that's why I found quality very sort of fascinating, almost sort of spiritual concept, because what quality essentially means is that you try somehow to capture what people want and need in order to make quality specifications and requirements. Then you're supposed to translate it into a language that engineers can understand and build the stuff. So it stands sort of in the between. What kind of technologies, functionalities, things can do the things that people want? So quality is the sort of abstract concept in the between. And that's why I think it's fascinating for both engineers and people in humanities and social sciences. Now, quality management in industry, in manufacturing, very quickly became a sort of mature field. So the Japanese methods that were coming up in the 1980s were rather quickly adapted in industries all over the world. So when I started my job at Aalto University, I realized that there's not much really to research. I mean, there's no mystery, so to speak. And if there's no mystery, there's no fascination and excitement. Because the methods are rather solid, and the methods in quality management tend to sort of get more and more sophisticated, and then they move from management into, say, system science, applied statistics, software design, and so on and so forth. So since the early 90s, the sort of quality management scientific community has been sort of repeating and repeating and repeating the same old things. So I thought this is very boring. But then for various reasons, I got into services. Spent a couple of years in a big research project with Finnair, the Finnish national airline company. We tried to develop the sort of cabin service and the customer service quality through a number of projects, and that was very interesting. But then, since about 15 years back, I got into healthcare. And the reason was very personal. And I observed that many of the healthcare operations management professors all around the world, they have similar stories like myself. Namely, I got sick rather badly. And the reason I got sick was a medical error. So I had a sort of ordinary, you know, the appendicitis, which is a standard simple thing, but it got complicated. And as a consequence, I got a number of infections in my spine and the hip bone. well, these things happen, shit happens, as they say. That's not the problem. The problem was that the process of figuring out the problem took almost 6 months. So here I am, a man in my best years, you know, ready and willing to work, father of four, and I have to spend 6 months, you know, in pain and, you know, running back to doctors and going here and there and walking with crutches and lack of sleep and all this shit. And then finally they find out the reason. It was just a simple infection. And then I got all these antibiotics and it was cured. But 6 months. I was there, it was in the summer of 2002. I was laying in the hospital. I had all these antibiotics going into my system. And I was really pissed off. I was thinking, 6 months. I went through in my head, you know, what they did, all these x-rays, MRIs, doctor's meeting, blah, blah, blah. And if you have managed it correctly, it could have been done in 1 week, easily. Maybe even in 2 days, if you have really squeezed this. But it took 6 months. So then, all of a sudden, I got an idea. There when I was looking at the antibiotics dripping, dip in my system, that, hey, I'm a piece of inventory. I'm like a GI, government inventory. Inventory management. And then, phew, two ideas connected. Namely, as you know, in industrial management, inventory management and process management has been the sort of key concept all the time since the 1970s, how to manage the process flows in factories and supply chains to reduce inventory. And you do it by sort of shortening the throughput time. And here I have a piece of inventory that had been kept in the hospital inventory for 6 months without, you know, processing it to the end. So I thought, well, why can't we start applying the industrial management methods to healthcare? Why hasn't anybody done that? And I thought this is a neat idea. So then I got well, I wrote a paper and got it published in the Finnish Medical Association's journal. I called it Patient in Progress. Like in the industry you have the work in progress or WIP. So this is Patient in Progress, PIP. So the PIP concept I suggest it could be used to study service processes in healthcare. Okay, I got it published, and then the phone started to ring, and I got a little bit of research funding, and hired a couple of assistants, and then a number of graduate students started to, you know, come because they perceive this is important, and then we started this research institute called HEMA, Healthcare Engineering Management and Architecture, which has now about, what, 10 people, and it has given birth to a company called the Nordic Healthcare Group, which is a sort of academic spin-off, which I founded with a couple of my students. I'm currently chairman there. We are the largest company of its kind in Finland. We employ about 50 people, of which 10 are PhDs. We do all kind of analytics, planning, consulting, data analysis for hospitals and municipalities and service providers. And very much into innovation. So I've been involved in a number of startups. And I've been through 4 bankruptcies, lost a ton of money. But finally, last year, I for the first time made some money out of entrepreneurship, because I was one of the early founders of a dental clinic called Mega Clinica, which applied the Indian Aravind Eye Clinic operations management system to dental care. And it became a success because it offered a special value proposition to dental care customers. So the price was less than in the public sector, but you could get an appointment very quickly for tomorrow or day after tomorrow. And the key thing is that you can have all your dental problems done in one sitting. So you don't have to come over and over again. You can have everything done. That no other dental clinics offer that. This can be done because of an innovation in the production management system and a piece of software that we developed. That was a really great thing. Then an investor, venture capital firm, bought the company, and I make a bundle. I was very happy after 4 bankruptcies, you know, finally a little bit cash coming in. That was great. So entrepreneurship and venturing is interesting in this field. All right, that's the background now. So the key concepts here in this course are operations and innovations. So this material that I prepared is mostly graphics and pictures that I've done in order to try to sort of explain the concepts that are involved. So operations, I believe, can be understood as resources and flows. Or if you think in a system model, stocks and flows. You have resources that are grouped into certain kind of organizational units. So you have hospitals, hospital departments, emergency departments. You have to organize resources in certain ways. So that's one aspect of the thing. Then you have process flows. And flow means what happens to the patient. So in the case I just discussed, you know, in my case, the flow was very slow. It took 6 months to do a thing that could have been done in a week. So that's the sort of flow aspect of it. The stock or the unit aspect of it, I believe, was that all these people who participated in my care, they have their own units, they have own scheduling systems, they have their own capacity utilization standards, and so on and so forth. So because they tried to run their units as efficiently as possible, the consequence was that the flow was very bad. If you want to have only a very good flow, meaning that the patient gets, you know, everything just quickly, on time, no waiting, like this, you can have it. If you go to the Apollo Hospital, most expensive premium departments, you can have it, but it will cost you a bundle. And why is that? Simply because, in most cases, they have to sacrifice the resource efficiency for flow efficiency. So that's why the trick of the trade in operations management, both in manufacturing and in services, is to how could you at the same time improve the sort of resource efficiency, the stock side, and the flow side, the processes. It's difficult, but it can be done, but it's not easily done. And that's why we need to discuss. So if you concentrate on one thing, it can be done. If you have to do two things at the same time, then it turns to be difficult, and that's why we need some smarts. Then we have the concept of innovations. Innovations, and the standard definition of innovations is that it has to be something new, but it has also to be repeatable, so to be able to do it more than once, and then it has to be useful. And useful both for the innovator and to the user. This is a standard definition of innovation these days. So it means that for something to be an innovation, it has to find some use, some sort of application. Invention is then the thing that connects with the novelty thing. You can have all kind of crazy ideas, but if you cannot repeat them or nobody finds them useful, then it's not yet an innovation. So in healthcare, innovations, as I said, are very much expected and called for. Then, on the operations side, the framework that I'm going to use during this course is called DSO, and that comes from demand supply based operating logic or operating mode. And this is a way to classify healthcare operations. I developed it with a couple of my doctoral students some years ago. I published a paper on it. I hope you read some of these days. So the idea behind this is that healthcare is typically perceived to be very complex. So you have all kinds of things, you know, various technical specialties. You have high-tech surgical theaters, and you have very much sort of low-tech primary care out there in the villages. So everything there being so it appears to be very complex, but complexity might be like beauty. It's in the eyes of the beholder. Complexity depends on, you know, way of looking. And if you look at healthcare as it were an industry with one industry logic, like automobile assembly, then it obviously looks like extremely complex. But you can sort of simplify complexity by segmentation. So you split it into certain kind of parts, and then each of the parts are internally homogeneous. So you take one part by part, then you can see, okay, this starts to make sense. So I explain the logic in during this course, but the sort of basic idea can be summarized in this algorithm that you can see there. It's leads to sort of seven categories. The first is prevention, which means the part of healthcare where you deal with people who are not yet sick, but will soon be if they continue as they do. Then there is an emergency care. It's an aspect where something happens and there is a time urgency. So you have to do things quickly, immediately, otherwise people die or come up with a permanent injury. So emergency is one thing. Then there is the kind of things that we call one visit, like say you have a dental cavity. It's not urgent, it's not severe, it should be done, but you know, whether you do it, I mean, you should do it, otherwise it will turn bad. But because it's a minor issue, then convenience and cost are important. So that's why the one visit part of healthcare is very much like retailing or fast food or stuff like that. It's a convenience driven. Then there are things called electives, which is say planned things that are not urgent but they are severe. So because they are not urgent, they can be planned in advance and executed in a sort of orderly way. So this is like say most cardiac surgery or surgical operations or medications. It's plannable, and in that sense it starts to look like a factory. Then there are things that we call cure, and these are health service processes that are not plannable because you don't know what the problem is. You have to sort of figure out the problem. That's why the process is iterative. It's like new product development, where you take one step and then you wonder where you are, and then you might have to come back and then you go forth again. So that's cure. And then care is the kind of situations you have in say elderly care or chronic conditions that there's no cure. So like diabetes, there's no known cure to that. And all these issues related to old age. I mean, if you're old, there's nothing to do about it. And people eventually die. So there are things that or medical problems that have no solution. But still you can do a number of things to make life better or postpone death or permanent injury by various actions. So these are continuous care. And then finally we have things we call projects. These are things that are extremely complex or very expensive, where you have to involve a number of various medical specialties or social care or financial arrangements or whatever. So it's like, say, shipbuilding, where every patient is a project and needs a project manager. Okay, so these are the seven DSO categories. And the assumption is that if you look at these seven as sort of, you could talk of them as different industries. So they have their own internal logic. That's what we are going to discuss during this course. The problem in healthcare is that they are overlapping. So you have these seven different businesses in one place.
What is the first one? Triple A?
Which one?
The first one, the DSO model. Triple A and question mark.
The prevention.
No, that is ill.
Ill. Is the patient ill? Okay, I'll explain this in detail in a moment.
And second one?
Urgent.
ED. Emergency department.
Okay, don't worry about it. I have a bigger picture. I'll come back to this in a moment. Okay, then we have the BMC, which is the business model canvas. It's actually a very smart management tool. It's developed by a German guy called Osterwalder in his doctoral thesis. The BMC, during this course, the idea is to use the business model canvas and the DSO So they go through different DSO categories, so the different sub-industries of healthcare, and try to, for each of them, discuss what is the business model. The business model canvas, the central part there is value proposition. And then they have these different parts. I also come back to this in a moment. The point with the business model canvas is that every business needs to somehow answer all the questions that are in the different boxes in this canvas. And the trick is that every box somehow is related to every other box. So the business model canvas is a quite neat tool, simple, only a couple of boxes, that you define one, then you have to ask yourself, how is this related to everything else? So for example, customer segments. If you start to work with a different or new group of customers, then you have to ask yourself, how will this impact my processes? What are the consequences to my resources? Will it change my cost structure? Would the revenue model have to be different? So for every change in one box, you have to go through every other box and ask what are the changes. So it's in a sense a very simple system model that helps you to sort of, in a structured way, think through various business models. Okay, so these are the key concepts here, and this is the structure we will go. So, oh, that was the introduction to the introduction. Now comes the introduction. So, let me help. Now, go into a question of methodology, so to the basic logic of the method. Now, if you just look briefly at the lecture material in the book, you will see that most of my PowerPoints are pictures or graphics, but you find no mathematics there, no formulas, and very little text. Why is that? It's because the purpose of this course is to help you and us to develop a sort of conceptual structure of how to think about services in general and health services in particular. So concepts. And concepts, if you have several concepts, then they are linked together into constructs or conceptual models. Why is this important? It's simply because when we approach the world, the concepts, the words that we use to describe certain aspects of the world are the sort of the places where we can grab and mentally sort of deal with the world. The problem in management is that most of these concepts are natural language words. They are not mathematical symbols, or they are not Latin words, or Sanskrit words. They are all plain English, which is a bit confusing. Because if you talk of, say, something like quality, you ask any Tom, Dick, and Harry on the street, what is quality? Everybody has some idea of what quality is. But when we talk about quality in management, then quality has a specific meaning, and that you have to learn. And the same is true for, let's say, productivity, efficiency, value. All these common words we use in a very specific meaning. And if you don't grasp that meaning, then you'll get lost. And I believe this is one reason why practical management is sometimes so confusing, because people use the same word in different meanings, and then one person talks about the forest, another talks about the woods or the trees in the forest. So that's why we had to be sort of careful with the concepts. And I know this is sometimes confusing, particularly to natural science and engineering students. So I've been teaching this for more than 20 years in Helsinki. And I always wonder why, say, when I've done a basic course in quality management, where I go through all these basic concepts, then students are very bright, but typically 50% of them don't pass the first examination. They fail. I don't know why. I mean, I've been talking to them, and I think it's simply that engineering students tend to be arrogant. If there is no math, then there is nothing. So plain English things are not sort of respectable for people with natural science background. I think that's part of the explanation for that. So be careful about the concepts. Now this picture here is, can we get the picture? It's an attempt to clarify this. Now here you have a medical condition. A medical condition is a health problem. So let's say a typical health problem that old guys like me tend to have, prostate cancer. It's a medical condition that is labeled as such. Now, how do we know that is that? We know it from symptoms. And the symptoms of prostate cancer is that elder gentlemen have certain problems with certain daily functions in certain parts of the body, and certain kind of pains and other things that can be observed. Now, based on these symptoms and observations, the medical sciences have developed diagnostics. And diagnosis, the word comes from classical Greece. The dia means seeing through or transparency. And gnosis means knowledge. So diagnosis is knowledge that you can, that helps you see through something, in getting into the core. So you think that, say, if you label a gentleman's problem as prostate cancer, then you have sort of capped, you have a name, given a name to it. And when there is a diagnosis, then that can be connected to a body of knowledge. Body of knowledge means a sort of the accumulated knowledge within a specific field. So in clinical medicine, there's a huge body of knowledge where all the diseases are classified. There's an international classification system called the ICD-10. It has, 16,000 different diseases plus any number of subcategories. So if you're a doctor and then you figure out that your patient has this disease, prostate cancer with the code, then the diagnosis is the key to the body of knowledge. And then you can go there and look at, okay, this is known about that, this medication works, this kind of procedures can be taken. And then a treatment regime can be started and administered. And then we look at the results. Now, in many diseases, the results are no good. Sometimes some people get help, some other people do not. So there's a lot of randomness there. So what does it signal? If you have, let us have the picture there. If you have this kind of outcome like the green things. Sometimes you get bad results, sometimes good, but there appears to be no structure there. What does it tell you? Well, it tells us simply that nobody's in control. we are not managing this. So you could as well, you know, just, you know, beat a drum and dance a dance and do whatever, the results would be the same, randomly distributed. So we are not in control. And that's a very nasty situation. We want to be in control. We want to, you know, cure, help people with medical problems. So what has happened in many fields of medicine is that the symptoms have, or let's say the medical conditions have been classified and segmented differently, more precisely. And now I'm not a specialist in oncology, but here are all these biotech guys, so you probably know more about this than me. There is this thing called system biology and genomic research and all these things that have little by little led to a situation where oncologists or the doctors that treat the cancer say that there's no such thing as prostate cancer. There are 6 or 7 different things that quite sort of randomly has been labeled as prostate cancer. We call it prostate cancer simply because it looks like cancer and it's associated with part of the body. But if you change the perspective to system biology or oncology or molecular medicine, whatever, then you use the classification principle based on how the cancer works. So the mechanism of the cancer growth. And if you do that, then you might come up with 6 or 7 or any number of sort of different types of cancer that affects a certain part of the human body. And if you have that, then you can figure out treatments for each of these types. And because this classification is based on the mechanisms of the cancer, then you can assume that you can, if you have medicines that attack exactly the mechanism of the cancer cell, it will be more efficient. So instead of having one diagnosis, you have 6 or 7. Instead of having one treatment, you have several treatments. And then, padam, you see, the results improve. So what's happening here? What's happening here is that our knowledge have been increasing. So we have more precision in understanding the situation. We have had to change the perspective from just a casual observation of human symptoms and problems and pains into the workings of cells and cancers and molecules and whatever. So that is scientific progress. Now, this the same kind of thing hasn't really happened in management, but this is what we want to do by developing sharper concepts, constructs, and models. So if you think of, say, a word like process, everybody knows what the process is. Everybody uses a word, process management, process improvement, process development, process this, process that. There's a peace process in the Middle East. Everything is a process. Everything in a Newtonian world, if you have time, in a world where you have time, everything is a process, right? So if everything is a process, then nothing is a process. In the sense that the word that means everything means nothing. Right? So, I mean, in that sense, it's useless. What we need is a sharper definition of the concept of a process, so that they know that we are talking about. And if you want to improve processes, we have to understand, you know, what kind of process it is, like in the case of cancer. So we are going to discuss some of these concepts of process later on during this course. But we can I'll say that, you know, a standard process and a routine process are two different things. A core process and a support process are different things. The process elements that produce value and those that don't produce value are different things. So we need to have this sort of sharper conceptualization of what is a process. So this is a point in all these concepts, definitions, models, and things.
What is the n here? Small n. Total number of presents? Small n.
Number of cases.
Number of cases.
Yeah, it's just an illustration.
Number of medical conditions?
Number of treated cases, okay. You could say. Yeah.
On the y-axis, it's n. Okay. N is maybe in the bad case, maybe 2. And maybe between bad and none, it will be 3. None will be just
a count. It's not real numbers. It's just an illustration to compare with this. Okay, so this is a conceptual framework that I think is very important. And there's another version of it, but let's talk first about this. So Professor Roy and I, we are going to write a book around this. This is rather central. and this takes us back to the philosophy of science. Now, we in scientific work we study certain kind of phenomena, like say cancer, like say diseases, whatever. Now the first question is about ontology. And ontology is the part of the philosophy of science that deals with the question of existence. So what can be said to exist and what do not exist? And what kinds of existence are there? So this has been I guess the Indian philosophers have dealt with this question because this is rather universal, but in the Western philosophical world this has been up for discussion since Plato and Aristotle's. And from these two gentlemen in ancient Greece come two different lines of thinking, realism and nominalism, which can be then illustrated by a simple question. Have you ever seen a bird? No. Have you ever seen a bird? No, I don't think you have. You have seen sparrows and starlings and pigeons and whatnot. But have you ever seen a bird? Right. Say. So this is a core issue of this ontological that what is the sort of reality behind the word bird? Because you cannot observe a bird as such. You can only observe instances of a bird. And then, I mean, you have seen bats. Is a bat a bird? It flies, right? A penguin is a bird. Yeah, but it doesn't fly. Again, so it's a sort of, not necessarily arbitrary, but unprecise classification that Carl Gustav von Linné in the 18th century developed all this classification of plants and animals. So it's a sort of grouping of things that is in some ways similar. So what is real? So Plato said that the concept of the bird is real. It's real in some kind of world of ideas. And all these birds that we see are sort of imperfect instances of that sort of fundamental concept of a bird. While then Aristotle said that, no. It's the pigeons and the starlets and sparrows, they are real. And these are only arbitrary classifications, abstractions. And the abstractions have no reality. So you have two sort of opposite views. And you know, people have been discussing this for centuries, that which way of understanding is the more correct. But this is not sort of empty philosophical pastime. Because we can say, apply the same question to, have you seen a market? Market. Like market economy. I mean, the same way. You cannot see a market. You can only see people who trade, buying and selling. Buying and selling is observable, but market is an abstract concept. And say, or you can say, have you ever seen an aircraft? The same trick as with the bird, you know. But is aircraft a useful concept? Yes, absolutely. Because if you don't have this abstract concept of an aircraft, then you could not discuss aeronautical engineering very sort of sophisticated, because you need to have this abstract concept that puts together a number of things that flying objects have in common, and then you, from that abstractions, you can then, you know, think of various different alternative ways to design aircrafts. So in that sense, the ontology of various things is important. So what is it that we are talking about? So in healthcare, for example, I have a doctoral student who I've spent a lot of time thinking, what is demand in healthcare? What is it really? And particularly, we talk of emergency department demand. So if anybody who shows up at the door on an emergency clinic, is that demand? Well, it's demand in the sense that somebody's there and wants to get help. But if we sort of define emergencies in a certain way, and we want to demand emergency services, then not everybody who shows up is an instance of demand. Right? So the ontology of demand is important, because if you don't get that right, then you start confusing and mixing, you know, all kind of cases that do not really sort of fit. So you have to be very clear and specific about what is it that you are talking about. Then the second thing is epistemology. That's the part of philosophy of science that deals with the question that what can be known. So what are the types of knowing and measurement? So how do you measure things? In social science, this is really sort of an important and often sort of weak link in everything. I mean, how do you measure demand? Really? Or how do you measure productivity? Or how do you measure the efficiency of the hospital? So what kind of things do you need? What is the first, you have got to have the ontology, and then you need to get into the measurements so that you can sort of know something about the thing. But frequently in epistemology, the two sort of key concepts are reliability and validity. You certainly know it's basic statistics. Some kind of data is very reliable, but then the question is it valid? And validity means that to what extent is that thing sort of connected to the thing that we want to know? So I've been always wondering, in health economics, there's been a lot of research on hospital productivity or hospital quality. There was a big study in Europe done where they used a number of this sort of metrics, of which one is mortality. Mortality means how many people die in hospital. So what is the epistemology of mortality? Yeah. It's a valid measure. It's a reliable measure. Because people typically are either alive or dead. It's digital. You are alive or you're dead. Sometimes people might climb up from a grave or whatever, but that's a rare case. Usually it's you're either alive or dead, right? So zero for dead, one for alive. So the measurement is exact. But the validity, what does it tell? If you are interested in comparing hospitals, if it's a hospital well managed or badly managed, and say that more people die in this hospital than in that hospital, can you say something about which hospital is better? No, you can't. Why? Exactly. Yeah. And what kind of patients? But yeah, criticality or case mix, as it's called. But still, you know, it's a huge study funded by the European Union, several million euros. And they tried to make a sort of study about comparing hospitals, and one of the indicators is mortality. I don't understand that. But these things happen. So this sort of illustrates what is the ontology that we want to study: efficiency or productivity or the quality of management in a hospital. That's the phenomenon which should have an ontology. But then, what kind of epistemology is leading to it? So how do we know that something is good, something or bad? What are the ways to measure it? That is a very sort of central question. And as I said, in health economics, health operations management, these things are not clear. And that's why you have to pay attention to them each and every time when you do research. So the variables and measures that are reliable and provide good data, like mortality, they are not necessarily valid. You cannot sort of learn very much from them. It's just nice to know. But still, sometimes, for example, in the United States, when surgeons are compared, and you also use the mortality. So how many surgical operations resulted in the patient dying on the table or soon after? So sometimes it's the better the surgeons, the more people die. Why is that? Simply, yeah.
Because most of the worst case will come to me.
Yeah. Because the best surgeons have a good reputation. And if a good reputation, that leads to a selection effect, that people who are very seriously ill, they want to, and they're afraid of dying, so they want to go to the best possible surgeon, and they pay whatever it takes, or as much as they can afford. And for obvious reasons, you know, a lot of people still die. So that's a sort of example of the problems that you have when you go from the ontology to the epistemology. But the epistemology is important because that gives numbers. That helps say, you know, answer the question, how much is much? How little is little? Is this stronger than that? Are there more of these than that? So you get the sort of the whole sort of empirical world opens up if you have metrics and measurements. Then comes the dynamics. And dynamics means that the question that what is impacting what? So what are the causes and effects? So if I do this, then what will happen? So management is all about dynamics. If I increase my prices, the prices of my product, what will happen? Well, in economics, there are sort of dynamic models that would say that, well, the demand for your product will go down, but your profitability per product will go up. So which one do you want to do? If you increase your prices, then you'll sell less stuff, but you earn more per unit. And then you can do all kind of trade-off calculations with which one you want to do. But in most cases, management, the dynamics is not very well known. You can always assume, you can take it as a basic assumption that if prices go up, then less people will buy. But sometimes that is not true. For example, in the luxury industry, the opposite is true. If you increase your prices, more people will buy. That's very strange. But there are these kind of segments with rich Chinese and Russians. You know, if you send some sell luxury goods like Swiss watches or scarves or handbags or stuff like that, the higher the price, the more people will buy. It's crazy. But this is an example, as I said, you know, like having a physical world where sometimes gravity goes up and gravity pulls you down. So in economics or business, sometimes, you know, the forces can be absolutely sort of reversed. So that's why it's very difficult to develop sort of universal dynamic models of behavior in economic settings. In the world of human behavior, there are very few sort of causal relations. So in most cases, you have probabilities or stochastic things. You can say that in most cases, most people do this. But you can almost never say that in all cases, everybody will do this. That won't happen, because there are always people who are stupid, who misunderstand, to take, you know, right for left or left for right, and so on and so forth. So you always have this kind of variation. So they are almost never causal connections that can be proved in social sciences, but probabilities typically can. Okay, and then we have the question of technology. So once we understand certain dynamics, then we can start developing technologies. So here's the same thing, a little different graphics. I think this thing could be summarized by saying that we want technologies. Now, unfortunately, I have a slide of this, but I recently read a very interesting book written by a Stanford University professor called Brian Arthur. And his definition of technology is rather broad. So he says that technology means the exploitation of phenomena for some purpose. So a technology you want to so he gives an example. Let's say think of a truck. A truck is a technology, right? So it's based on two basic phenomena, natural phenomena. What could those be? A truck is an exploitation of phenomena, natural phenomena. Two fundamental phenomena. Any ideas? Any mechanical engineers here? Yeah, how do we get acceleration? Okay, yes, yeah, you are into it. Yeah, simply there is a phenomenon in nature known as combustion. You have certain chemical substances, carbohydrates, that can be turned into, let's say, diesel fuel. So there's a phenomenon that if you put a spark there, then it blows like that, right? So it causes an explosion because it ignites very fast. That's combustion. Now, this is a phenomenon that you can observe in nature. It has its ontology. So it's called combustion, right? What is the epistemology? Yeah, how much energy, how fast it explodes, and type of fuel, different types of fuel have different kind of, so you come up with a rather complex epistemology, a number of measures about this phenomenon. And the dynamics, well, that's the force, you know, if it have this amount of fuel, then this is the kick that it gets. Then you start to exploit this. You start to use this phenomenon. How do you use it? Well, you put it in a box that's strong enough, and we call it a cylinder, and then you sort of put a shaft, a piston, and then you put a spark inside, and you get the explosion inside a box, and you create a movement, and then you capture that movement with the shaft, and then so on and so forth. So the internal combustion engine is a technology that exploits a phenomenon in nature, fundamentally. Then, of course, exploits several different other phenomena, like, say, the properties of steel that can take some heat and some mechanical power or spark plugs or whatever. But the core phenomenon is combustion. And when we talk of trucks, then the other one is, of course, the wheel, which is a phenomenon that says that the sort of rolling movement with the wheel is sort of easier than if you have to drag something like that. No? So based on these two things, you can think of a technology called a truck. So in that sense, technologies exploit phenomena that are found in the world. And now, if you want to build technologies, then to solve problems in healthcare, then we need to know something about the fundamental phenomena out there. So that's the point. In this sense, this picture is, can we have the picture on the screen? It's not necessarily linear. The sort of science policy that the Finnish and the Indian governments and whoever tell us is typically based on a model where you assume that first you have to do the sort of basic science to discover all these phenomena, and then you do all this empirical research, and then you go to applied science, and then you develop technologies. That happens occasionally. So there are some technologies that are sort of first developed as very abstract things, like, say, radio signals. First, this mathematics, sometimes before the war. What was his name? It was this famous mathematician who developed some of the very basic formulas in signal processing, who died saying that he's so happy he has been a professor of abstract mathematics, and he has been able to spend his whole career doing something that is absolutely, definitely not useful. Only abstract, elegant mathematics. Then, 20 years after his death, his mathematical models become the core of a very useful area of signal processing and mobile telephony and what have you. So there are cases where the starting point is in the ontology of fundamental phenomena in nature or the biological world or society. But there are also cases where it starts from the other end. And where the technology comes first. The perhaps the most famous example of this is the steam engine. Steam engine was developed by a number of guys in the UK in the 60s and 70th century. Thomas Newcomen was the first. There was one guy before him, Thomas Sawyer. Newcomen built the first sort of steam engine that could be used. And then Thomas Watts was the first who made these sort of commercial applications. And that was in the 1730s, 40s. But these guys were illiterate. They didn't know how to read or write. They were sort of blacksmiths in villages, but they were tinkerers. They were sort of playing around, building things, and trying this and trying that, and experimenting, and they blew up things, and then they reconstructed them, and went on and on, and they sort of discovered something that you can really sort of create movement based on steam, or the steam expansion that you have in steam. So they build these machines without knowing what they were doing. So they're starting from the technology came first. Then 100 years later, in the 19th century, Lord Kelvin was the guy who developed then or explicated the first laws of thermodynamics. So science came later to explain what technology had created. So Lord Kelvin, his formulas explain what these illiterate blacksmiths had made into reality 100 years before. And that has happened over and over again in the history of technology. That you just come up with something without knowing what you are doing, and then later on you sort of science is used to explain why technology works. And I think in management that happens all the time. Like say lean production or supply chain management. Lean production was not developed in any labs. It evolved slowly, mostly in the Japanese automobile industry, starting in 1950s, little by little. They tinkered with this and that and tried this and that, and they did it because they were desperate to figure out ways to make better cars cheaply so they could export and buy food for their country. So it evolved, and nobody knew about this until the 1970s, the oil crisis in 1974, and then the second 1978, when the oil price went through the roof and the car industry took a big hit. And Toyota was the only remaining standing. So all of a sudden, in the world of automobiles, something remarkable thing happens. Some companies sort of started to make extraordinary things. But nobody knew why. So what happened then was that in MIT, in Boston, Massachusetts, a group of management scholars banded together and started, got funded a huge research program called the International Motor Vehicle Program. So they studied all the car assembly plants in the world. They developed a metrics of quality and productivity, assembly hours, blah, 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 very detailed. And they collected data for all the plants in the world, and they demonstrated with data that the Japanese assembly plants are the best. And so they started wondering, what's going on there? What are these guys doing? And so they landed in Japan and went to the factories and looked around, and they wrote this book, a very famous book called The Machine That Changed the World, from 1990. It's still worthwhile reading, but take the sort of second edition. And in this book they explained in industrial management and microeconomic terms what the Japanese had been doing. And it was nothing real sort of mysterious, because the success of Toyota was funded on, it could be easily explained by simple microeconomics, like say inventory, inventory terms, cost of capital, quality, the cost of poor quality, repair costs, factory layouts, and so on and so forth. So there's no mystery. On the mystery, there was that, why are these guys doing it when nobody else is not doing it? So then the sort of the focus turned into how could the Japanese, you know, get their people to do things that everybody would talk about but nobody could execute. And this took the discussion then to management methods and culture and social environments, human behavior, and so on and so forth. But anyway, it was the situation that technology came first, and then later on science came and tried to sort of explain why it works. Now, so where should we start? It doesn't matter. So in this picture, I perhaps should draw it as a circle, because there is no sort of given linearity here, that you should start with the conceptual model and then go to technology. You could start with technology, or you could actually start anywhere. There are many instances where you can start with the epistemology. It has happened many times simply that data becomes available. In many cases, you know, in research and healthcare, it's difficult to get data. But if you can, say, persuade a hospital operator to give you their data, then data becomes available, and then you can start the whole thing from the epistemology, that now, when I have this data, then what can this data tell me? And then you can move this way or that way. Or you can start from dynamics. A little bit of simulation, and you discovered that there are some sort of dynamic relationships somewhere, then you can start from there. So there's not necessary linearity. All these things need to be there, but you can start from this end or that end. Okay, I try to follow this logic then through this course, that always if you want to sort of collect the thoughts and sort your ideas, then ask what is the ontology, what is this thing, and what is it not? Then ask what can be known about it? What are the things that can be measured? And then ask what is the dynamics involved here? What is sort of affecting what? And then comes the question of technology. What can be done? So what kind of technologies can be developed to exploit this thing? So that's the basic methodology. Okay, go through a few slides more. Now, operations management is a field of science. It's a little bit confusing because in some universities talk about operations management and some places about industrial management. It's essentially the same. But you can say that this field of science can be looked like this picture. Now I know there's error in your material. Some of the words are in Finnish. And here is the English translation. The idea is that coming back to what I said, in some instances you first have the natural science that looks into ontology and the phenomena, then like say the mathematics behind signal theory, then comes product technology, so design the products, then production technology, and these are different things. I mean, to design a mobile phone is one thing, and to design a factory that can produce 10,000 copies of the mobile phone per hour is another thing. So the product and the production technologies are, but you know all this, right? And then comes the question of how to organize production. And that is where operations management comes, steps into the picture. So production needs to be organized as a socio-techno-economical system. So you have the technological foundations there, the machinery and the product and stuff. Then the all production is a social system. If you have robots only, then it's not a social system. But if you have human beings involved, then all production systems are more or less social systems. People relate to each other. People command and obey and relate, and that needs to be designed somehow. And then there are also economic systems, because most of the things going on there cost money. People don't do things without getting paid. So all this money is involved, and that's why it becomes an economic system. So then that's why I can say that then next to operations management is sales. So you have to sell something. And in order to sell, you have to do marketing, meaning that you have to understand the market, that what do people want, how they behave, what kind of communication do they listen to, and so forth. And then you need finance and strategy and so on and so forth. So this is how we look at operations management. Now if you think of healthcare, I think the same logic can be used. You have life sciences, then product technologies equals clinical medicine. No, that's general medicine. Production technologies, clinical medicine, meaning that the research into clinical methods, that how do you cure a person with certain kind of illness, and also pharmaceuticals. Then healthcare operations management then is the field that looks into how health service production is organized as a social techno-economical system. What are the technologies used there at the basis? How do humans relate, and how would the money flow in the system? Okay, this picture essentially illustrated what I said a while ago. But operations management aims at effectiveness. And we talk about effectiveness and efficiency are two different things. What's the difference? Efficiency and effectiveness. Yeah, that you say. So efficiency is sort of single thing. You have you are supposed to know the right thing. Then is just the question, can you do it in the right way? But then when you have the question of trying to understand what the right thing is, so the selection of the right thing that and doing it right, then you talk about effectiveness. So effectiveness is a sort of a broader concept that includes the finding the right things and doing them right. So that suppose you can say that resource efficiency is a sort of single factor thing, and flow efficiency also, they need to be combined. So that's what is the aim of operations management. Then then we have the concept of innovation. So innovation, I think in economic terms, could be called trade-tested betterment. That you develop something that is better than things that have been before, but it has to be trade-tested. So simply that you yourself think this is good is not enough. You will have to have it market tested. So other people have to pass judgment and pay money before you can say that something is sort of an innovation. So the, as I said, the modern or standard definition of innovation includes these three things: novelty, repeatability, and usefulness. So novelty can mean also different things. It's said that there are things that are new to the individual, things that are new to the discipline, and new to the world. Now, you guys all probably get a lot of things today that are new to the individual. That's what learning most of the time is. But it's not yet sufficient. New to the discipline is what happens when methods used in one discipline are moved to some other discipline. And healthcare operations very much has been that kind of thing. The things that have been learned in industry, in manufacturing, in the car industry, has been then transferred to healthcare. And in that sense, it's new to healthcare. And it can be said that it's an innovation, even though to the world it's nothing new. But to healthcare it is. Now, by the way, that has been so far the healthcare operations management sort of main task, to pick up things from industry and translate them to be used in healthcare. And there is a whole lot of books called Lean Healthcare or Lean Hospital Management or Advanced Lean for Healthcare and so on and so forth. So it has been useful to some extent. And I believe Admiral Singh next week will tell you more about this, because he has been involved in a lot of these things in India, both in the military side and civilian side. But I believe this effort has already run its course. You cannot say keep sort of importing ideas all the time. You can import some ideas and they will be found useful, but I believe it's time for to develop an operations management thinking that is new to the world, that sort of comes out of healthcare, but is not only adaptations from elsewhere, but it develops it in a new way. The DSO model thinking is an attempt to do that. And I, by the way, realized that this is happening. I was some while ago giving a lecture to people in manufacturing. And I said, you know, I've been working with healthcare for 15 years. I don't understand a lot of your things, the heavy machinery or lifting equipment or whatsoever. So I said, it doesn't matter. Tell us about healthcare. And so I was telling about our research in healthcare, and these guys who were in heavy machinery industry, they were very excited, because they started to see that, gee, there are some new ideas here that they could apply. So my belief is that in the near future, healthcare becomes sort of the dominant industry, where all the new things are thought up, and they will then flow to other industries. Indeed, I mean, most of the time in the history of management, there has been some leading industries. So certain industries that have been hot, in the sense that that's where the new ideas come from. And when they are hot, it means that they are growing rapidly. They are paying good salaries. They draw the smartest students there, and because there is a growth, there is also money to fund various new things. So in the 1960s, it was steel and shipbuilding. And in the 70s, 80s, it was automobiles. Then in the 1990s, retailing was the hottest industry with Walmart and all these things. The supply chain management thing came up with this various thing. So retailing was the leading industry for quite some while. Then in the 90s, it was banking and finance. That didn't end very well, but banking and finance used to be sort of the place where things happen. Now, I don't think there, right now, there's no general consensus of what is the leading industry, but I would say it's healthcare. Well, that's a place where the new ideas come. Okay, so that's the novelty. Repeatability means that an innovation needs to have a software, sort of program, receipt, formula, so that it can be repeated independently of the innovators. And then is the usefulness. I mean, if it's not useful, then nobody will buy it and it will not fly. So these things, three things needs to be present before we can talk about innovations. But of course, think about innovations, you have to work with the parts before it becomes a whole. Now maybe we could take a little break, 10 minutes, and come back, continue then.